The highlands of New Guinea are one of the most remote corners of the world. But for my friend Mary Jo McConnell, this is the only place where she can do her unusual work. As we head deep into the Arfak Mountains, it was hard to find drivers willing to make the trip. But even at 70, Mary Jo is determined. It's her obsession that's driving the expedition. We're on the trail of a mysterious bird. We arrive past midnight. The welcoming party's been waiting up for us with a ceremonial feast. I woke up in a farming village called Hunku. For the locals, our arrival means a day off from work.
Good morning, Abileso.
Moses Saiba is the chief of Hunku. He has known Mary Jo for 15 years and has been anxiously awaiting her return.
Karena Mary Jo adalah sebagai keluarga kami, sebagai orang tua kami, mama kami, sudah beberapa tahun kami juga panggil bahwa kami punya mama tahu, orang tua sama Mary Jo.
It feels great. I'm excited again. I never really dreamed I'd get back. I can't fix it. You have to carry it like this.
It's getting harder for Mary Jo to make the trip, but she says her work compels her to return.
I'm sure tomorrow, when it's time to go up there, everything will come together just fine, and I think I'm going to get the best paintings ever. He's carrying my canvas for me. He's going to carry up to my fragment of paint.
Very important thing you have there, huh?
Mary Jo is an artist. And to reach her elusive subject, we'll need to travel hours more up the mountain.
That's our hotel, and the home fires are burning already.
The villagers build Mary Jo a base camp every time she visits.
Hotel Hunku.
Hotel Hunku.
Yay.
Few outsiders come here, so Mary Jo is a one-woman tourist industry.
Beautiful.
For a couple hundred US dollars, they've pulled out all the stops.
They built me a beautiful house again. They put this floor all together with fern fronds, and they built me a kitchen, and they're now cooking me a dinner with chicken.
From our base camp, we plan to hike further into the rainforest. We're looking for the creature that's consumed Mary Jo's life since she first visited here in the early 90s. The cloud forests of New Guinea are home to thousands of plants and animals unknown to scientists, and Mary Jo collects them along the way.
What's that?
Pitcher plant, cobora. They call it cobora. It has an antibiotic in it. He puts it in his ear for an earache.
This is for.
There's a bower right up ahead here.
Bower.
Finally, through the brush, we see what we had come for. It's called a bower. Incredibly, a bird the size of your fist made this roof of woven twigs and carefully arranged a pile of seeds in front. According to scientists, the bower is built to attract a female. The bower, with the most striking collection of flowers and seeds, will give the bird that built it the greatest chance at reproducing. Mary Jo still recalls when she came upon a bower for the first time.
We went through swamps and muck, and we saw a bower. And I just sat down with tears in my eyes. And it was just this green moss mat with flowers beautifully arranged. And I just couldn't believe that a bird could have done this. So I decided, but I wish I could just paint these things. That's my Leonardo. Leonardo always has a feather, and if he has two, he has them crossed.
Leonardo is one of four birds whose Bowers Mary Jo has tracked over the years. She's come to think of him and the others as artists, each with a distinctive style.
Andy Warhol, he's a very unusual guy. He's had a tin can that he's had for about 15 years, an old sardine can. And he usually puts it in a different arrangement. He'll arrange it with an empty battery or a piece of tape. And he's not as concerned with composition as he is as making a statement about the way that the forest is changing. It's kind of hard because you don't have an easel.
Mary Jo starts her portraits in the field. As she works, she says she can't help feeling a personal connection to the bird.
The more I started watching the bird working and working along with him, the more I realized he was doing exactly the same things I do as I work. And when I found the bird, I found in the bird a soulmate.
Mary Jo will work up here for days, sketching out her canvases. Meanwhile, I still wanted to see the Bower bird for myself.
So we're going to Bower 3.
Moses led me to a favorite spot where he says we're sure to find another Bower. And hopefully, the bird itself.
Mm-hmm. And that's the Bower bird saying, get away from my Bower. Somewhere out here.
Moses calls them the clever ones.
Sampai tahun 2019-2094 itu Mary Jo tiba di sini baru. Jadi kami panah dan juga kami buat jelat dan juga kami merusakkan hutan. Tapi sekarang ini tidak. Pertama kali saya bertemu Mary di Hungku, saya pikir itu turis biasa, dia jalan-jalan saja. Baru dia bikin foto itu, baru saya pikir bahwa
it's just an amazing place in the world that no one seems to know about. I can let my fantasies go wild.
This is where Mary Jo finishes the paintings she began in the forest. She sees her work as one artist's tribute to another. Mary Jo lives in Marblehead, Massachusetts, but even here, she's made a life among the birds.
Hi, Millie. Breakfast is ready.
For years, Mary Jo has bred birds of every stripe. But her walls are a study of the one bird that has captivated her the most. The clever one. And its vibrant bowers. It's a project that's intriguing to more than just artists. For the last 15 years, Mary Jo has been a kind of secret agent for Harvard scientists, bringing back rare samples from parts of the rainforest few of them ever reach.
Mary Jo, back in the early 1990s, in the middle of her project of painting bowerbirds, showed it here at the museum and volunteered.
This is the material.
Scientist Gary Alpert is always amazed by what Mary Jo brings back.
You can see it's very unusual, silk bag, and it was full of caterpillars. Literally, probably moth caterpillars, larvae. And so it's extremely rare for scientists to ever see these.
That's fabulous. That's what I want to do, is just collect all the things that I can from this little micro environment.
And I have an artist who's literally has a sharp eye and a memory and who's painting and who's going back to the same site year after year. That's golden for a collection.
They went up to trees like you do for a coconut, you know, and brought down a case. And I think maybe they eat the insect inside it.
They might.
Mary Jo's happy to be of service to science. But she has a theory of her own about the bowerbird.
I'm convinced they're artists. They have had no formal training. They've had no books. But they see the same kind of joy and beauty and wonder in something that I see. Artists all through the centuries have used light in different ways. I have become over the years so aware of how the bird is using light. He chooses a place in the rainforest where there's a hole in the canopy, and he always faces his bower to the east so he gets the morning light. But notice how the sun is coming down, making reflection and making this material shine now. Can you see that? The shine on there, the shine on here. Actually, I found a quote in Darwin, who's saying that there's no doubt in my mind, he says, that the bird finds pleasure in building these bowers. Which made me very happy, because there are very few scientists who will think that the motivation is anything other than mating or attracting a female. I want the world to know more about how wonderful these birds are. This whole land is going to disappear, and these bowers are going to disappear, but no one will ever know.
These days, the people of Hunku are holding on to their land and their way of life, but just barely. A new road is being built by the Indonesian government, and the local chiefs are being pressured to let the modern world in.
Jadi kami mengerti bahwa untuk ajaran juga penting untuk membantu kami juga untuk hasil bumi kami dari sini ke Manokwari dan Lain City. Tapi untuk kalau lewat Hunku itu saya tidak izinkan. Membantu pemerintah untuk mekarkan artinya supaya membesarkan. Tapi untuk hutan kami tetap lindungi.
The villagers are very concerned right now because many of the chiefs are selling off their land. There is gold and copper underneath this rainforest. And the game is to first sell off the lumber rights and make some money that way.
Mary Jo knows the chiefs will sell out if they think it's their only option. So she is developing a project to bring clean drinking water to Hunku. And she's working with Moses, designing low-impact trails to lure ecotourists and bird watchers.
Jadi pendapat saya untuk Hunku saya lindungi supaya lama kelamahan mari diperhatikan saya untuk berikan satu yayasan atau satu proyek untuk saya itu saya juga sama seperti orang Bali dan orang Boston Amerika.
Back at the Bowers, Mary Jo's trip is coming to an end. And she's still trying to capture the work of Leonardo and Andy Warhol. But I suspect the clever ones will always be one step ahead.
Okay, I think I got it. I think I got the feeling for it. I think I know what he's trying to say.
There's much more to explore on our website. Discuss the world and tell us what you think of our stories from a small planet at pbs.org/frontlineworld.